Welcome to another episode of the Bandage Podcast, a weekly wrap-up of the most trending healthcare news. Each week, we'll discuss the latest in healthcare, health IT, and compliance.
In this week's episode, we discuss the West Nile virus, new indicators for kidney disease, and a hospital impacted by a tornado. Let's wrap things up. This is episode 94 for the week of July 19th. I'm Matt Moneypenny.
And I'm Albert Battistelli.
Before we get started, our diagnosis code of the week is R61, generalized hypohidrosis.
Otherwise known as excessive sweating.
Yes. I don't know. I don't think a lot of people know what hyperhidrosis is, so thanks for the clarification. Something I'm very familiar with, you know, myself. I'm sure right. You are as well, because you're a big-time runner, so.
Know all about it.
Anyways, let's get right to the news. First up, we have West Nile in Cali. California announced that it has recorded the first death related to the West Nile virus for 2021. Doctors recommend that Californians check their window screens and remove stagnant water from their properties since the virus is transmitted through mosquitoes. California's health department identified the West Nile virus in 177 mosquitoes from across 13 counties throughout the state. The CDC says that 80% of the infected people do not display symptoms, but when they do, they can experience fatigue, fever, headaches, body aches, rash, and swollen lymph nodes. There is no vaccine or specific treatment for the West Nile virus, so stay vigilant when regarding mosquitoes.
What do you do to get rid of mosquitoes, Matt? What are some of your... are you a tiki torch guy? Or are you like light a candle?
I'm a big tiki torch guy over here. You know, I just love the smell of citronella. I'm just kidding. Citronella smells terrible. I wish they would make it smell a little bit better. What's crazy about this story and what's crazy about mosquitoes in general is, you know, they don't have a vaccine for West Nile virus. So like their solution is to just try to kill all the mosquitoes that have West Nile virus, which means like genetically mutating mosquitoes in some cases. Like they're trying everything. They're pulling everything out of the book with this one.
That's some like Jurassic Park level stuff, though. That kind of freaks me out. Like if I get bit by a genetically modified West Nile mosquito and end up like
spreading
extra limbs or...
We accidentally get a massive mosquito that just roams the world and is Jurassic, you know. Maybe that's something that they're going to talk about in the new Jurassic Park movie that's coming up.
I don't know. Stay tuned. I hope so. Next is answers for diabetic kidney disease. Scientists have known for a long time that people with diabetes are at risk of kidney disease. However, they've struggled to figure out if type 1 or type 2 is the reason behind the increased likelihood. Researchers conducted a study with 800 people with type 1 diabetes, and they compared their findings with data from a past study involving people with type 2 diabetes. The researchers discovered specific indicators that are significantly different between the two groups. Not only does this help answer the question at hand, but also helps doctors figure out how to treat people who are more at risk for kidney disease.
So it goes from diabetes to kidney disease. Very interesting. They must be intermingled in some capacity. I'm interested. It's kind of a small sample size. 800 people, I mean, isn't that big, especially for a medical study. So this must just be like a preliminary study, I'm assuming.
Yeah. And they compared it against a past study too, which kind of is strange. It's like, we're only going to study people with type 1, and then we're going to compare it against previous data for type 2. But I feel like you'd want those two control groups at the same time. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. We're not medical researchers, but
we're not.
Hopefully.
We just get to talk about them.
Yeah, we just get to give our unabridged opinions about them.
Unscientific opinions.
Yeah, exactly. I imagine this is true, but that hopefully that the type 2 diabetes study that was the one that they're comparing the type 1 with has the same population, which I'm sure it does. But, you know, if it doesn't,
yeah, I would think
whoops.
So. Whoops.
Next up, hospital versus tornado. You guessed it. Tornado wins. The Southeast Health of Stoddard County Hospital, located in southwest Missouri, endured damages due to a tornado last week. The hospital sustained damage to the roof, some walls in the back of the building, and it is currently without power. About 22 patients and 40 staff members had to be evacuated from the facility. The hospital's goal is to restore the emergency department operations once power and utilities are restored. The clinic will be in contact with patients if any delays to reopen occur.
I think my favorite thing about this is the headline there, hospital versus tornado. It sounds like some sort of like Spike TV movie or like, I don't know, Sharknado.
Oh yeah, it's true. Like, it could be a whole movie.
I just imagine
a whole nother spinoff.
Yeah, like them squaring up. Like, I don't know. Either way. Like
hospital with punching arm or punching gloves ready to go, ready to duke it out. I think, I mean, so not much you can do if you're a hospital versus a tornado.
No, you're kind of stuck like in one spot.
Yeah, in like reality, I mean, it's definitely unfortunate, but that's just kind of the problems that a lot of hospitals face, especially if they're in the tornado area of the United States.
Yeah, so I wonder if they have like specific training to like, I don't know.
They should.
In the case of tornado, like...
Right.
All patients to the basement. Like, I don't know.
They should. I think a lot of the times, I mean, it's called a disaster. There's that, right? There's the whole procedures of what do you do with patients, especially in the emergency room. Like, that sounds like a hairy situation. But
yeah,
what do you do after the fact? Right. Because that's kind of where they're at now. They're trying to pick up the pieces and continue to operate and provide healthcare to patients who need it. Which obviously, if anyone needs immediate help, they're supposed to go to a hospital, but they can't go to a hospital if it got damaged by a tornado. So
right.
Hopefully they have a disaster recovery scenario in place, specifically, I mean, even beyond the physical aspect, but also on the data aspect as well. Mm-hmm. Otherwise they could lose a lot of, pertinent information and help and information that helps doctors do their jobs and treat their patients, which I imagine they do, but
yeah. I figure they probably have some sort of archive or some way that's stored. Hopefully. Have you ever seen a tornado up close?
I've seen lots of funnel clouds. Almost a lot. There was two times in my life where a funnel cloud was like right over me, like where I was. I was like, oh my gosh.
Oh boy, here we go.
Oh yeah. Boy, hospital versus Matt. I mean, tornado versus
tornado
Matt.
Tornado versus Matt?
Yeah.
Whoops. Hospital versus Matt. That's a fight I'd watch. Oh my gosh.
What about you?
I distinctly remember like when I was little, like having to like take shelter in like the girls' bathroom of the elementary school I was in, because it was the first time like I'd been in, like the girls' bathroom, and I felt like we shouldn't be in here, but it was like a tornado, so it was okay. But it was just like a lot of like things going on in the mind of an 8-year-old who's like scared, but also like, what is this new place?
Yeah.
So I think so, but I don't remember anything like, I don't remember wind damage or anything like that. I just remember that experience of being like ushered into this safe place with no windows.
Jeez. I know. Yeah, that's a scary situation. It seems like, you know, child Albert was more worried about being in the girls' bathroom than the fact that there was a tornado outside.
I was very much more like, are we okay? Is this allowed? Like, I don't want to break any rules.
And with that, let's go into our next segment.
BREACH, Breach Patrol.
It's a breach!
All of the latest cybersecurity breaches.
Welcome to Breach Patrol, where we talk about the latest and biggest and scariest breaches all across the world.
All right. First up, we've got a story about Mint Mobile. Mint Mobile data breach allows hackers to port phone numbers. Mint Mobile, a company that sells mobile phone services to T-Mobile Cellular Network, was hacked between June 8th and June 10th. Mint Mobile sent an email to customers last week informing them of what occurred. The data breach allowed several phone numbers to be ported out to another carrier. Only a, quote, very small number of subscribers were affected, but Mint Mobile has not specified publicly how the customers have been affected. Subscriber data was also possibly accessed, including names, numbers, email addresses, passwords, and account numbers.
So it seems like, so Mint Mobile is like a phone, like a third-party T-Mobile phone seller, essentially, is what I'm getting at.
That's what it seems like.
Yeah, it's... just one of those things where it seems like it's an unfortunate area for Mint Mobile specifically.
Mint Mobile. It's kind of hard to pronounce, isn't it? Mint Mobile. Yeah.
Not to be confused with the Intuit's Mint app, which is a financial app.
Which I have on my phone, and I had to do a double take when I was reading this. Like, wait a minute. Am I
at risk gonna get fished? Oh my gosh. Yeah, exactly. The data breach, several phone numbers reported over to another carrier, and they say only a very small number, which could just be them kind of saving their own skin a little bit. As far as the data is concerned, you know, names, numbers, email addresses, passwords, and account numbers. Obviously, passwords and account numbers is a big one. Mm-hmm. And then so if you are a Mint Mobile user, obviously change your password, and hopefully you don't use the same password for every account that you have. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, that gives the hacker access to everything.
That's a bad practice.
It's not good. Don't do it. Don't do it. But even beyond that, if they only get into your Mint Mobile account and they like you don't have any financial information or anything inside of it, you still have to think about the phishing attempts too, right? You know all those phone numbers or those random phone calls you get talking about your car's extended warranty. Mm-hmm. Well, this is kind of what ends up causing that something, some sort of breach that leads to phishing attempts. So, you know, you just got to stay vigilant. We've said this before on the podcast. Albert hasn't yet, but
I haven't. I'm new. Hi,
you know,
I'm Albert.
You want to say stay vigilant for the audience members for your first time?
Oh, I'd be honored. Stay vigilant, guys. Stay vigilant.
Nice. Perfect. Perfectly executed.
All right. Thank you.
Next up, custom hack for custom t-shirts. Spreadshirt, Spreadshop, and Team Shirts inform clients that they have been hacked. Details of customers, partners, and employees were all affected by the event. Clients were warned by an email of a security incident and that companies were investigating the extent of the breach. The email warned that postal addresses, bank account details, PayPal addresses, and passwords before 2014 were accessed from the company's servers. Spreadshirt has advised customers to change their passwords and posted some password safety tips on their website. Wow. So this is way worse than the last one. I mean, you know, just because bank account details were expressed and so were PayPal addresses and passwords and email. I mean, that's like the five horsemen. Is that five horsemen or four? One, two, three, four horsemen.
Four horsemen.
Of data breaches, right? So that's trademarked now. Now that I've said that, because that's
pretty sweet.
Nobody
can use that, please.
I like that. Yeah. If you use that, you're going to get sued. I'm just kidding. but, you know, I mean, it goes to show you too that whatever you make an account on, it doesn't matter what industry it serves.
Yeah.
It's you know, you could get hacked.
Yeah. And what's scary here too is it wasn't just customers and employees, it was partners as well. People who had partnered with
that's
these
companies.
Scary. Like when you're exposing your partners to that kind of risk, that's bad news, man.
I imagine it seems like based off of this story that Spreadshirt, Spreadshop, and Team Shirts were either all using the same provider for their services or are all owned by the same parent company. And they're all just kind of like cater to different niches or something like that. But I mean, I think I've used Spreadshirt before, so maybe I should go check my emails. But yeah, that's really scary. Also, what's not that great is how Spreadshirt advised their customers to change their passwords and posted some password safety tips on their website. A lot of times when breaches happen, and you'll notice this, Albert,
You will.
A lot of companies, what they end up doing is when they have a breach, they're like, hey, here's a year of free credit card monitoring services. And in this instance, that's not the case. I mean, maybe they're going to do it eventually. Maybe this breach just happened too soon and they, you know, it was so big that they had to have some sort of retaliation or some sort of safeguard in place to help inform their clients. But man, that's not a good look.
And finally, the last story of the day. Iran's train stations experienced chaos after a cyber attack. Hackers posted fake messages about train delays or cancellations on display boards at the station. They also posted the phone number of the country's leader as the number to call for information. Earlier that day, trains across Iran lost their electronic tracking system, which wasn't immediately clear if it was a part of the cyber attack. A railway company spokesman said that the disruption did not cause any problem for train services.
This sounds like something out of the movie either Bourne or Die Hard or any of those government attacks. Type. Yeah.
Yeah. Weird.
Where it sounds like a terrorist attack. It really does. It sounds like the beginnings of. Definitely scary. I don't really know. I mean, I guess, you know, the worst case scenario would be, you know, the trains can't communicate to each other and then they run into each other on the tracks. That could happen, I feel like.
I think my favorite part of this story is the spokesman that says it did not cause any problem.
Like, yeah, lucky for him.
Right. I would imagine that, like, if I was looking at train delays and cancellations on the board, like, I'm sure it caused problems for some people. But it just seems like nothing to see here, nothing to see.
Nothing to see. Like, carry on, you know, just your regular day. Yep, no big deal. They're just probably trying to suppress it as much as they could.
I know.
Nothing happened, guys. They were all
trains
delayed.
Are running like normal. This is what we do every day.
It's just maintenance time. It's not a big deal. Just go past it. I mean, seems like, you know, situation was avoided. The worst case scenario was avoided, which is good.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, this isn't the first time that we've seen breaches happen where cyber hackers get into infrastructure-based systems. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had that in the United States like four times this year already. So it seems like since one happened and it was such such a big attack in the United States or, you know, across the world. It's just opening up a can of worms and all the hackers are trying to get in because they can now and they figured it out. So scary. It
just goes to show you got to do those risk assessments, see where your vulnerabilities and weaknesses are and make sure that you're
absolutely
you're covering yourself there because you don't want to expose your, your company or your, especially like, I mean, these are civilians riding these trains.
And
you want to make sure that you're protecting the people that you're serving.
Exactly. And that's it for this week's wrap-up of your weekly healthcare news. I'm Matt Moneypenny.
And I'm Albert Battistelli.
And we'll see you next week.
Thank you for listening to the Bandage Podcast produced by eTactics.